much for the invitation to speak in this conference. My issue are new readings and new texts about Marx Capital. But let me start with a personal remark about reading Capital. I'm reading Capital since roughly 43 years, and I must say it didn't become boring to me all the time. Reading Capital, when you try really to, in an intensive way, to read Capital, I would say it is a kind of intellectual, adventurous journey. But reading, in order to enjoy such an adventurous journey, reading means something else than what nowadays in the European university system is usual, where reading, at least this is my experience from Germany, just means to receive some main thesis of a text. Reading Capital means not only to have some rough content, it means to reflect the structure of the arguments, the different levels of abstraction, and also, not the least point in order to understand Marx, also to become clear about the role of metaphors in Marx. Marx uses not only economists as his sources, he also uses philosophers, theologians, writers, Shakespeare, Goethe. And this is not only an ornament of the well-educated citizen, what Marx also was. I think most of these remarks have a very strict sense in the argument of Marx. And a good reading of Marx should have all this in its view. So this just as a remark to start. Now I will talk first about new readings and then about new texts and new insights we could have from the second mega Jan is already introduced. When we speak of new readings, then there must be old readings. With the old readings, I have in mind readings of Capital, which were dominant in the first half of the 20th century. These readings, of course, they depend on the whole political and social situation, on the level of class struggles and so on. I cannot show this in all details. I just want to focus on three points which formed these older traditional readings, three more or less intellectual points. First, when we talk about Capital, we have in mind three volumes, but the first volume appeared nearly 30 years before the third volume. So this first volume dominated the discussion, and this first volume also dominated the issue. Capital was seen mainly as an analysis of capitalist production. Volume 2 just as an appendix, and from volume 3, people took out some points which seemed to be interesting, but very rarely really realized the total connection of the three volumes. So, first point, we can observe that there is a domination of volume 1, for the whole discussion. Second point, we speak of three volumes of Capital, but Marx planned four volumes. And the fourth volume is nearly forgotten in many discussions. The fourth volume should be a history of the theories. What very often is taken as a substitute for this missing fourth volume are the theories of surplus value. But they are not at all a compensation for this missing theory first. It deals mainly with one category, surplus value. And secondly, it was a part in the formation of Marx's insights. Theories of surplus value is more the protocol of a research process than a kind of classic presentation of the history of economic theory. So we definitely miss this fourth volume, and this means also we miss Marx's concluding views about the classics and his differences to the classical theory. We can find a lot of remarks in Capital, of course. We can reconstruct these differences, but I think that such a presentation of Marx himself is missing is also a point which had a big influence in the discussions. And then the third point, maybe the most important, but also not very deeply realized point influencing the discussions and the reception of Capital, is the rise of marginal utility theories just after volume one had appeared. Marx gave to Capital the subtitle Critique of Political Economy. And what he aimed with this critique when he should give names or theories, it was classical political economy. Adam Smith, David Ricardo, Sismondi, and a lot of other persons. To whom he pointed critique? His own value theory. By the way, he never used the term labor theory of value. He always speaks of value theory, should be a critique of the classical value theory. But after the rise of marginal utility theory in the late 19th century, a new gap, a new front line emerged, the line between labor theory of value on the one hand and utility theory of value on the other hand. And Marx was put to the classical school, just as a version of the classical school. This was done as well by the bourgeois economists, but also a lot of Marxists accepted this division. On the one hand, the classics with a labor theory of value, on the other hand, the neoclassics, the bourgeois vulgar economy with a marginal or a utility theory. So the difference between Marx and the classics was furthermore neglected, and this also shaped the discussion to see in Marx's theory just a version of mainstream economics, a better version, but a version. Labor theory of value was received as a kind of theory of labor embodied in production. The production process already seems to determine value and value objectivity. Money and credit was seen just as an appendix to capitalist production of commodities, and this capitalist production seems to be the essential content, money and credit just an appendix not so important. And also crisis theory was seen as a theory mainly rooted in the conditions of capitalist production. These views dominated the first half of the 20th century. They dominated also the view on socialism or communism. It was seen, socialism, as the necessary result of the contradiction between a private capitalist production, stressing production again, and the social nature of the production. And in so far, this private form has to be changed. But the forms of production were not so much in view and were also not so much in discussion. So what later was called socialism in the Soviet Union, it had a lot of similarities with very capitalistic forms of production. Since the 1960s, we can see a lot of new readings of capital. New readings started in several European countries, in France. The school founded by Louis Althusser and Etienne Balibar, in Italy, the Operaism with Tronti, in West Germany, what was later called Neue Marx-Lektüre, New Reading of Marx, founded by Backhaus and Reichelt. A little bit later, also in the Anglo-Saxon world, new readings of Capital started. Important was here especially the translation of Rubin's study of value theory. And at the end of the 70s and in the 80s, also in East Germany and the Soviet Union, started a kind of new reading connected with the addition of the new mega, which led to a much more deep understanding and discussing of Marx Capital. Now I want to focus on the German Neue Marx Lektüre. It is too much to talk about all these different attempts. I just want to point out some main features of Neue Marx Lektüre in Germany, which then also led me to come to the point why the publication of the new mega was so important. In the West German discussion, it was stressed since late 60s that, contrary to the old readings of Marx, we don't have a kind of Marxist economics, which is just another version of mainstream economics. It was stressed that Marx delivers a critique of basic categories and not only of results of bourgeois economics. So when Marx speaks of critique of political economy, it is not only a critique of certain theories, it is aimed to criticize a whole science, the science of bourgeois economics. And this critique starts already with the very basic categories of commodity, of value, of money. In this context, labor theory of value was not anymore seen mainly as a tool of explanation of price relations, but it was seen as a theory about how a society of private producers constitute. How is it possible that in a production where by the division of labor everybody depends on anybody else, nevertheless the production is organized privately, meaning all the producers behave more or less if they were lonesome Robinsons. How is it possible that these two elements come together? This labor theory, this question labor theory can answer. And in this context, two concepts in the German discussion became very prominent, which until then were underestimated. The first concept was fetishism. Fetishism not only as commodity fetishism, what was known since Lukács studies in the 20s. Fetishism also continues money fetishism, capital fetishism, and is connected to what Marx called mystifications. We have also a mystification of the value of the labor power as value of labor. We have mystifications of the ground rent, and all these mystifications at the end of volume three come together to what Marx called the Trinitarian formula. So this is also an important argument that you shouldn't isolate volume one, what was for very long time done in the discussions. You have to read all the three volumes together. Only then you also can catch such an issue like fetishism. Fetishism is not only an issue of chapter one, it is also an issue of the end of volume three. So fetishism was very present in the German discussion, and the other issue which was present in the German Neue Marx-Lektüre was value form analysis. The old readings of Capital, the old discussions, they focused mainly on the labor content. Value is determined by labor time, by social necessary labor time. This is true, this is not to neglect. But when you open the first volume of Capital, when you look on the first chapter with its four subchapters, what is the longest, the most extensive subchapter? It is number three, about the value form. And exactly this subchapter about value form for a long time was nearly neglected. It was read just as a kind of abbreviation of the historical process in which money appears. But this is totally wrong. The chapter, the subchapter on value form has nothing to do with a historical chapter. It is a chapter about the connection of categories, why the category of value makes necessary an independent value form. And why this value, this independent value form, has to appear in the form of money. We need the money form. In chapter one, we only treat the money form. Money itself appears in chapter two as the result of the action of the commodity owners. Also, this was a very important point in the German discussion, to distinguish the form analysis, the analysis of economic forms, and the analysis of economic action. Every bourgeois economic theory starts with the action of the homo economicus, and presupposes a certain rationality. In Marx's form-oriented approach, the rationality of commodity owners is not a kind of natural rationality like in bourgeois theories, it is the result of a certain form. And also, God, I see the time is running. And another point which was very important for the German discussion, I just mentioned it, was to see capital as a social system of impersonal domination, which is specific for the capitalist mode of production, deeply different from the personal rule in all pre-capitalist societies. This new Marx reading in Germany already transgressed the limit of the three volumes of Capital. Texts like Grundrisse or Urtext were included. And my own approach to the reading of Capital is rooted in this new reading, but the difference, what I tried to contribute to the discussion is the following. In the German discussion, there was a consciousness that we cannot see capital already as a ready-made project. There was a famous term, we have to reconstruct the logic of capital or out of all these manuscripts, of the capital manuscripts, but also of the manuscripts like Grundrisse, which come before. I have big doubts that such a reconstruction is possible. In my work, I try to show that in Marx's Capital, we can find deep ambivalences, even in the basic categories of value and commodity. So there is nothing to reconstruct. There is not a hidden core, and we can, as a treasure-seeking person, just take out this core. No, we have to face with the ambivalences we can find, and these ambivalences, just to mention it, in my view, they are rooted in the fact that in Capital we can find two different but permanently intersecting discourses, one discourse of a scientific revolution, of a break with the field of classical economics, and on the other hand, a discourse which still is trapped in this classical discourse. And these two discourses, the discourse of a revolutionary break with the tradition and the discourse fixed, trapped in this traditional discourse, they are intersected and they produce specific problems, in my view, for example, the famous transformation problem. So, now to talk also about the new texts and the new insight by the texts, I will come to the new mega, which already was introduced by Yanis Milios. This mega, especially for the German discussion, brought a big push, and also for myself, I must say, whatever I wrote and did in the last 30 years, it wouldn't be possible without mega. And also now I think mega is worldwide more and more recognized and led to more and more new translations of Capital. Yanis already mentioned the new Greek translation. We also have new translations in Italy, in Brazil, in Slovenia, in Persia even. They all use the new texts also produced or published in Mega. Mega, it is important, it is historical critical edition. This means Mega has not the aim just to present a ready-made text. This text doesn't exist. Mega presents the development of texts. And you saw already here in the, as a slide, all the six volumes in Mega, which are devoted only to volume one. And also, Yannis already talked about the apparatus, that to every text volume in Mega, we have an apparatus with all the variants and corrections and so on. So, what are the results from this Mega? First, Mega is not ready until now. Ready is only the second section with capital and preliminary manuscripts. Two problems were discussed mainly in the past regarding the insights of Mega. The one problem is the problem Marx as an author and Engels as an editor. Now that we have Marx's original manuscripts, we see that Engels did a lot of intervention with a very honest motives. He tried to make the Marx manuscripts more readable, more easy for the reader, but he imposed a lot of structure. For example, when you see the usual edition of volume 3, most of the title of the chapters and subchapters, and also the division between them, is not from Marx. All this is done by Engels. Engels also removed certain parts. He newly structured some chapters and he changed nearly all formulations. There is nearly no non-sentence which has not at least a small alteration by Engels. The mass of these alterations are really improving the understanding, but there are also a number of alterations which change the meaning. So this was a big, or maybe still it is a big, discussion point. Another point which was discussed mainly in the last years is the concept with which Mega started, that we have three drafts of Capital, the Grundrisse, the manuscripts of 61 to 63 with theories of surplus value as a part, and the manuscript of 63 to 65, and then the final Capital starts. I think this view now by the publication of the manuscripts proved to be wrong. First, we have to distinguish two main projects. The project of a critique of political economy with six books, the book on Capital focused around the concept of capital in general versus competition, and different from this, the project of the four volumes of Capital, not anymore connected with the six-book plan, and above all, not anymore connected with the category of Capital in general. This category by Marx was abandoned after the year 63. It didn't appear in any manuscript, in any letter, in any published text. It was, in my view, substituted by analyzing the relation between individual capital and total social capital on different levels of abstraction. So there is not just one division, individual capital, total social capital. There are several divisions on several levels of abstraction. How much time? 10 minutes or
a quarter. Minutes.
Okay, so I will try to condense. Until now, I spoke about structural consequences, the Marx-Engels relation and the development of the texts. Now I want also mention some insights in the content of the theory we can have from the new Mega. One important insight regards value theory. In the year 1987, in the Mega volume, second section, volume 6, also Yannis mentioned him, for the first time, Marx reworking manuscript from the first to the second edition was published. This is a very important manuscript for a deeper understanding of value theory. Why? It shows not only how meticulously Marx reworked the presentation of value theory in the first edition. This manuscript, on 3-4 pages, also gives us a kind of self-commentary of Marx. We can observe there Marx as a reader of Marx. And the reader, Marx, there sees that his presentation of value in the first pages was misleading. It was misleading insofar that one could have the impression that value is an attribute of a single commodity. And in this reworking manuscript, Marx states very clearly that we cannot speak of a single commodity. I quote here the English translation of one sentence from this manuscript. He wrote that a work product considered in isolation is not a value, just as little as it is a commodity. It only becomes value as a unit in relation to other work products or in the relationship wherein the various products are equated as crystals of the same unit of human labor. And where this equation took place, it took place only in exchange. This means without exchange, we cannot speak of commodity, we cannot speak of value. Value is not just the result of capitalist production, it is the result of capitalist production and exchange. This is very clearly stated in this reworking manuscript. It is much more clearly there than in any other Marx text I know. And this reworking manuscript also had influence on the text of the second edition of Marx Capital. Marx introduced certain changes. For example, in the section on fetishism, there is a famous paragraph where he tells us that only when the products are exchanged, they receive value objectivity, Wertgegenständlichkeit. Before exchange, this value objectivity, of course, is in the mind of the producers. They produce because they want to produce value. but it doesn't exist. The existence of value objectivity we have only in exchange. So this is one field, value theory. We can learn a lot from the new edition, from new texts. Another field is crisis theory, where we can learn many things, but I want to shorten this. Just a remark, crisis theory, when we study usually Marx crisis theory, what we are using, we use volume 3 and we use theories of surplus value. Volume 3 rests on a manuscript written in the years 1864-65. Theories of surplus value were written in 1861-63. But Marx still continued working on crisis after 65. Already in 66, a crisis appeared in Great Britain, which changed Marx's view on crisis. He could realize for the first time this is a financial crisis which took over the production sphere. Before, he saw financial crisis always as a kind of epiphenomenon. The essential thing has to happen in the production sphere. Now he learned that this is not the only possibility, and he started to make a lot of excerpts on finance, of money, of the money market. These excerpts, until now, they are not published. They will be published in section 4 of Mega. So, with the help of the excerpts in Mega, we can learn that Marx's research process on crisis didn't stop in the year 1865, but our usual reading stops with the manuscripts of this year. And then the last point I want to mention for what we can learn from the new Mega texts is a contribution to the old discussion about the validity of the famous law of the tendency of the profit rate to fall. It is a lot disputed if this law really can be proved, if Marx succeeded in giving a proof, or when he not succeeded, if we can substitute something. I also published about these issues. I have big doubts. I think this law cannot be saved. But from Mega, I think we can learn that there are at least some hints from the 1870s that Marx himself had big doubts about this law. First point, the last mentioning of this law in Marx was in the year 1868 in a letter to Engels, where he just gives an overview about the chapters for Volume 3. But in all his discussions on crisis in the 1870s, in his letters, in his manuscripts, he never related to this law what was said before it is so important. In the late 60s, there are some shorter manuscripts where Marx did accountings on the rate of surplus value and the rate of profit. And there is one big manuscript which he wrote in the year 1875. A lot of accounting of number examples, and it becomes very visible that Marx's assumption with a rising organic composition of capital, we will have a falling rate of profit. No, it can happen, but it must not happen. And in so far, I think a note also widely neglected in the discussion, Marx did in his hand copy of volume one, and Engels published it, so the note we know since the end of 19th century, there Marx states just the opposite of the falling rate of profit. In this note, you can find in the chapter on accumulation at the end of the first volume, Marx states that the capital with a higher composition of a higher organic composition also has a higher profit rate. This is exactly the opposite of what he stated in the year 65 in the third volume of Capital. So Mega gives us a lot of new insights, but I want to conclude and come to also to the end of this presentation with a further point, which is usually not often connected with capital. This point is communism. Capital is also a source of communism, of the meaning of communism. And I think this point is especially in the contemporary political situation an important point which deserves more attention from us. Nowadays, we are confronted with a new wave of right-wing movements all over Europe and also in the United States, already with certain election results, and maybe this year, 2017, we will see more success of these right-wing movements. These right-wing movements, succeed in getting a lot of disappointed persons, and they offer to them a kind of utopia, a very backwards utopia, the utopia of a nice nation state which can solve all the problems when all the refugees, all the persons who don't belong to the core of the nations are gone. We are very good in criticizing this utopia, but an utopia not only consists of arguments, it also consists of hopes, and this utopia gives hope to a lot of people. And these hopes you cannot just answer by good arguments. I think also the left needs their own utopias, and communism, for which Marx gives certain hints in Capital, could be such an utopia. Communism, not in the sense of the so-called real socialism as we could find in the Soviet Union. This is a system which totally failed. But communism also not in a pure philosophical sense. In the last years, we had some interesting philosophical discussions about communism. I think we need a discussion about communism as a concrete social project, how a society can be structured. And in Marx's Capital, when we read with attention, we can find a lot of small, sometimes not so small hints to a society beyond the commodity form, beyond money, and beyond a state, a central power. And I think this utopia of a communism informed by Marx's Capital, this should also be included in a new reading of Marx and a new reading of Capital. And I think regarding the actual political situation, this would be also a point where a purely academic discussion, which usually we have, can transcend the pure academics, can become a discussion which intervenes in political processes, and this was what Marx aimed. Capital, he called, is the most big, the most effective missile thrown against the bourgeoisie, and as such a missile, we should use it. Thank you very much for your attention.